Good morning and welcome to our Lord's Day worship, and we do hope that the service is a blessing to you. The flowers that are by the communion table are in loving memory of Jim Cushing. We had his memorial service here yesterday. And the flowers that are on the flower stand are placed by our flower committee. Every week, a group comes in and takes care of the flowers. They want to beautify this place so that when we gather, and usually it's only five or six of us in this space, that you see some beauty. And we're so grateful for the people who have been tending the grounds and this building, because one day we will be back. I want to welcome back Molly Rohde. It's such a joy to have her here today ministering. And I also want to welcome one of our members, a lay reader, Hugh Mulliken. When I first came to this place, Hugh promised me something. He was on the board at the time when I accepted the call here, and he said, I will work side by side with you. And he was good to his word. And many of the beautiful improvements that we take so for granted now in this building came out of Hugh's drawings, and then he was our foreman for so many of the projects that we had here, including the accessibility project and our steeple repair. So Hugh, it's such a joy to welcome you back as a lay reader. Let us turn our hearts to worship the Lord.
Sometimes blue, glad that I ran into you. Tell the people that you saw me passing through. Tell the people that you saw me passing through. Tell the people that you saw me passing through.
Good morning. Our call to worship is found in Psalm chapter 27, verses 1 through 5. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is a stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, that will I seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire of his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent, and he will set me high on a rock. Please join us in singing "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."
Come to that time of worship where we bring our praise reports and our prayer requests. Tomorrow is my son's birthday. Happy birthday, boy. He's probably not watching now, but he will probably in a few hours. And 10 years ago today, my son and I landed at the Green Bay Airport and took up residence here in Ephraim, and then Bob followed 2 days later by car with the dog. And we're so delighted that we've been here 10 years. For our prayer concerns, we want to remember Kathleen's mom, Marion, who's in hospice care, and also remember all the caregivers. There's so many people across this nation who are caring for loved ones. We want to remember the family of Jim Cushing. Grief does not begin or end with a memorial service, and we know that it will be a long time of grief for the Cushing family, and we remember remember them in our prayers. We want to remember the family of Katie McConkie. Katie was a young lady who was a Door County native. She was so much a part of the fabric of this area, and she was murdered last week. Her funeral service will be September 1st, and we remember her and the so many people that she touched in this area. We want to remember people who are undergoing cancer treatments, Dean and Angela, who was a friend of the Carries. We want to remember young Jaden Michael, all the hurricane victims, and also violence against people of color in this nation. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we are so grateful to be here today, so grateful for the grace and the mercy that extends to us, so grateful that you've given to Robert another year of life, so grateful for the 10 years that we have been here. We thank you for the joys and the love that has been showered upon us. We would remember today Kathleen's mom, Marion. We ask that you would be with her on her final journey, that you grant her your peace and your grace, that you would be with all those who are caring for loved ones. We know the special stress that they are under, and we ask that you would lift burdens and give them your peace. We would remember Jim Cushing's family. We ask as they continue to grieve his loss and celebrate his memory, that you would grant to them your comfort. We ask that you would be with the family and friends of Katie as they gather to mourn her loss. We ask that you would give to them your grace and your peace beyond measure. That Dean and Angela might know that underneath them are the everlasting arms as they continue cancer treatments. That Jade and Michael would continue to grow and be strengthened. For all of those who are rebuilding after the hurricane, that you would give them the resources and strength they need. And Lord, in our nation ripped apart by violence, we lift up especially our friends and our neighbors, that you would grant to them your peace, that we might see each other through your eyes as all beloved children of God. We ask all of this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
because with you I'm whole, without you I'm cold. So if you think about me where you are tonight, then you ought to be
Our first scripture lesson is taken from the prophet Jeremiah. O Lord, you know, remember me and visit me, and bring down retribution for me on my persecutors. In your forbearance, do not take me away. Know that on your account I suffer insult. Your words were found, and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart, for I am called by your name, O Lord. God of hosts, I did not sit in the company of merrymakers, nor did I rejoice. Under the weight of your hand I sat alone, for you had filled me with indigestion. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Truly, you are to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you turn back, I will take you back, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and do what is worth and not what is worthless, you shall serve as my mouth. Is they who will turn to you, not you who will turn to them, and I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. Our second scripture lesson is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good, love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another, do not be naughty or haughty. But associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take the thought of what is suitable in sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, pays the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on the heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our reflection is written by Kathleen Harris. I like old 60s westerns. Despite outdated scripts and cringeworthy costumes, they evoke safe feelings of my happy childhood. On Sunday nights at 9 p.m., we'd gather around our TV and watch bonanza horses gallop across the Ponderosa. Villains are always caught and justice continually served. Today's scriptures offer safety from enemies through faith in God. Paul continues last week's lesson in his letter to the Romans with specific instructions. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the needy, he writes, and practice hospitality. The prophet Jeremiah heard it this way. Utter what is precious, not what is worthless. Why then be fearful when the Lord is our light and salvation? Why indeed? Some days I see enemies everywhere. This ain't no Ponderosa. I think crossly. Suddenly, the image of the Napalm girl pops in my mind, and then a newsreel of an ordinary airplane strangely turning north, stranging along the North New York skyline towards the North Tower. Today, in 2020, there's an invisible virus and natural disasters. I can feel like 50 years of exhausting bewilderment. I'm hoping Pastor Don shares insight to today's service. Until then, let's remember moments of grace. The return of our national symbol, the bald eagle, from the brink of extinction. The 50% decline these past five decades in morality, of children with cancer. Two Super Bowls, victories for the pack. Four if our timeline stretches back to 1967. Life has been beautiful, fun, and filled with miracles. It still is, even now. What Jeremiah learned is true. God is no fickle babbling brook. He stays with us in our long suffering. They will fight against you, the Lord revealed to his prophet, but will not overcome you.
Sun's falling in the sky. Now leaving leaves me sadder. I just can't figure why. Seems my sense of balance is suddenly upset. 'Cause this time something's not finished yet. I've got a list of 40 babies, 32. 17 supposes another summer closes without answers to my questions about maybe, what could be. Autumn's around the corner, Labor Day is here, time to close the door on this county for a year. I don't mind the leaving, still I feel regret. 'Cause this time something's not finished yet. No, this time something's not finished yet.
Let us pray. Lord, I ask that all my words and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Christ, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Last week, I asked about hanging by a thread, and I challenged us to climb up the thread. So today I'd like to talk to all of those who heard that message and said, I've got a scissor ready to cut the thread, because I am done. I've looked around and I see injustice everywhere, and I've tried my best, but I am done. I've looked around, and even though I've tried to go high, everybody else seems to be going low, so I am done. I've looked around and I'm sick and tired of wearing masks and washing my hands every 5 minutes. I'm sick and tired of being closed into my house, I am done, and I'm not afraid of dying. Now, I do have to say something about that. Pretend I'm your mother. I understand that some people are really tired of this. I understand that some people are not afraid to die, but I've got to tell you, a little fear is a good thing. God put it in us. He called it the survival instinct. So wear the mask, wash the hands, keep your distance, and even if you're not afraid for yourself, take care of somebody else. That's my soapbox for today. We're done, aren't we? It is so hard, and we are so weary, and we feel just done, and we're ready to get the scissor and clip the rope. There's a man in the Old Testament that would understand exactly where we're coming from. In fact, he had it a lot worse. His name was Jeremiah. He was a sensitive young man. I'm sure he had a lot of hopes and dreams for himself. And one day God came along and said, "You're it. And you have to speak to these people. It's a corrupt nation. And they're going to go into disaster if you do not speak to them." And Jeremiah said, "Why don't you find somebody else? Somebody older, somebody wiser, somebody with more gravity than I have." God said, "No, it's you." And so Jeremiah took on the mantle that he had not asked for, and he took it on with not only grace, but with enthusiasm. He said, "I ate your words," which means that he internalized God's words. He was not only God's mouthpiece, he was also living what God said. It was part and parcel of who he was. So enthusiastically, he took on this role, and he spoke to the powers that be, and they answered his challenges. They answered his words with abuse. Not only oral abuse, but physical abuse. They threw him in dungeons as quickly as they could. They loathed this man, but he still preached. But at this point in his life, he finally says, "You know, I'm done." And I guess he thought that if he insulted God, maybe God would take him out. So he said to him, "You know, you're a deceitful brook." In other words, "I heard the babbling sound of a brook. I went to get a drink and it was dried up." And I love God's response to this man. He doesn't say, "Poor Jeremiah, I'm so sorry that I put such a burden on you. You need a break." No, he doesn't say that. What he says is, "If you turn around," and by turning around means to repent. "If you repent, if you turn around, and if you utter what is precious and not worthless, I will be with you." What does that mean, uttering what is precious and not what is worthless? What is precious are those things that have weight, that have gravity, that are healing, those words that are positive, those words that have impact on people's lives. What is worthless? Well, we know what is worthless. 3/4 of the stuff that comes out of our mouths are worthless. And we not only have the ability to speak what is worthless, we can type what is worthless. And that's even more dangerous because it seems like our fingers don't think as we type these awful screeds that then we put on social media. That's worthless. And so we need to elevate what we say and how we speak and how we interact and what we put out on social media. And God says, "If you do that, I'll be with you." Now, we don't have Jeremiah's response in writing, But we do know that he ministered, he spoke out for 40 years. He might have been done at chapter 15, the chapter we read today, but God said, I'm not finished with you, and you are not finished yet. When I read Paul's letter to the Romans, they didn't have an easy time either. They were living in an oppressive government regime. That government wanted order at all costs. And disorder was defined in many different ways, including how you thought. Your religious ideology could be considered a threat. And so Paul was a threat to Roman order. He understood what it meant to live in difficult times. His people understood that. And poverty was criminalized. It was a terrible time to live. And what does he say to the people of Rome? He doesn't say, go hide in a bunker. He says, keep doing. Provide hospitality. Take care of the stranger. Do justice. Do whatever it takes to be a child of God. Something is not finished yet. As long as there's injustice in the world, something is not finished yet. I admire the people who 57 years after the March on Washington are there again. Why are they there? Because something's not finished. And they're not going to give up hope until all people are treated justly. Something's not finished. Beloved, something's not finished in this county. We have people in this county who are working 2 and 3 jobs and cannot make ends meet. Something's not finished. We have people who are abused in their homes. Something's not finished. We have people who live in quiet desperation. Something's not finished. And we are not done until God gives us that last breath. So whatever God has called you to do, if you are parents at home with little children, you know you can't say I'm done because your kids won't let you. Something's not finished. You need to raise those children to be good, noble, wonderful people, citizens of the world. That is your task that God has given to you. If you've been called to the streets, stay on the street until the work is done. Whatever God has called you to do, we are not finished until God calls us to our heavenly home. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you. I thank you for Jeremiah's lament. I thank you that you gave him all those years of ministry. And I thank you until your kingdom actually comes to pass in this world, that you give us each a task to do, and your peace and your strength will be with us until journey's end. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.